Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I know most of you are familiar with the Christmas story, but have you ever wondered if animals can talk and what they would say about Christmas? Tonight, two special kids are going to get to see Christmas through the eyes of their barnyard friends. Now, let's begin.
Man, I sure hope I don't get any more socks and underwear from Grandma. Getting clothes on Christmas is the kiss of death.
Oh, Jimmy, that's not a nice thing to say. Be thankful you get anything at all, young man.
Well, it's not like I get her denture cream or her favorite perfume, Ben Gay, on Christmas.
That's not perfume, you dork. But Jimmy has a good point. If I get one more ugly Christmas sweater for Christmas, I'm going to snap, just like a gingerbread man.
No, you guys are lucky to have sweaters, socks, and underwear. One year growing up, all I got for Christmas was an apple.
Dad, you grew up in the 80s, not the Depression.
Same thing. The point is you guys are ungrateful, and your grandma treasures you and loves you more than life itself.
Sorry, Dad. You're right. I do love her stories.
Yeah, like the one she told us that one time about the animals that could only talk at midnight on Christmas Eve.
Yeah, she said that if you listen closely, you can hear them tell the very first story when Jesus was born.
Oh, kiddos, you know Grandma likes to make up all sorts of stories. You know animals can't talk, and don't even think about asking to go down to the barn tonight.
Oh, Mom.
Come on, guys, you heard your mother. It's time for bed. Chop, chop, now get.
Can we stay up and watch Polar Express?
Yes, but do not be too loud.
No Wi-Fi.
Oh, great. Now what are we going to do?
Dad changed the Wi-Fi password.
How do you spell Gibraltar again?
Forget it. I have an idea. Let's check out the barn instead.
But Mom and Dad aren't asleep yet.
Are you kidding me? You can't hear that chainsaw, Dad snoring?
Jimmy, that's Mom. Dad has a gargoyle, remember? Let's go.
Is the coast clear? I think I saw the lights go out in the big house.
Yes, the coast is clear, although I don't understand why you felt the need to hide from those dear children. They wouldn't hurt a fly.
Yeah, right. They'd probably take a can of raid to poor little roaches like us.
Or try to stomp into next week.
I remember poor Uncle Leroy. Poor guy, all he did was try to get a little snack out of the refrigerator after Thanksgiving Day. It's not like they didn't have enough to go around. I'll never forget him. May he rest in peace.
Amen.
We roaches have to be mighty careful.
I love listening to the Christmas story again every year. I love everything about Christmas. The tree, the tinsel, the lights, and the sweet delights. Strings of popcorn and candy canes, taking a swim in a punch bowl of eggnog. Oh, it's my favorite time of year.
I know, and there are presents, and Santa always shares his cookies with us if we've been good little roaches. It just makes me want to dance.
Well, why don't y'all entertain us old-timers with a jig? I'm in the mood for some good old country music anyways.
Yeah, let's cut a rug.
Mommy pop popcorn and we'll string it on the tree. Apples, nuts, and candy, oh what a Christmas feast. Daddy play the organ and we'll all sing solid night. We'll have a good old country Christmas, all right. Our present Christmas Eve about midnight, we'll have a good old country Christmas, all right. Make pallets on the floor just like we always did. Grandma's bake the pies and cakes. Oh, what a pretty sight. We'll have a good old country Christmas, all right.
Happy Christmas, that's what it's gonna be. With all the family gathered around our pretty Christmas tree. We'll open up our presents Christmas Eve about midnight. We'll have a good old country Christmas, all right. A good old country Christmas, that's what it's gonna be. With all the family gathered around our pretty Christmas tree. We'll open up our presents Christmas Eve about midnight. We'll have a good old country Christmas, all right.
You roaches sure know how to liven up a party. But as late as we're staying up, if those people wake me up at 4 a.m. to get another bucket of milk, I'm going to move to the next county. Why can't they just use the powdered stuff? It exists, you know.
I don't know what you're complaining about. Cow tipping starts at 2 a.m. and those crazy humans think it's hilarious. I'm no pushover. Get it? See what I did there?
Oh, get over yourself, you overpriced side of beef, sirloin. It's not like you're barnyard royalty or anything.
Well, I'm just stating the obvious. If the humans really want to laugh, they should scare the fainting goats. Now that's hilarious.
Coming.
See what I mean? Now that's scared straight.
Hello, children.
Check out the goat. That's hilarious. Wait a minute. Did you just talk to me?
Yes, I did. And don't worry about Gilbert the goat. He'll come around in a few minutes.
This is so cool. Grandma was right.
The kids at school are never going to believe this.
Can you tell us the story of the very first Christmas?
Well, first of all, we don't need a repeat of Charlotte's Web or Babe or even Zootopia. Everyone remembers Nemo and the scandal that was. We like our peace and quiet. We are only allowed to talk to humans one night a year.
That's one too many, if you ask me.
What Sirloin is inadequately trying to say is, we need you to promise that you won't say anything to anybody. Nobody wants to end up in a county fair, understand?
They're rigged anyway.
We promise.
All right then, quiet down everyone, and we'll begin the story of the very first Christmas in history. My name is Dale.
Hi, Dale.
Now, I've been a donkey for as long as I can remember.
Oh no, here we go again.
You'll have to pardon Dale. He's getting dementia. Quick, Bacon Bits, jump in.
Hey, I resent that. It's pork loin, and don't you forget it. I can't believe we're related.
Just recite the Bible verse already.
Luke chapter 2, verse 1. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed.
Taxes? I'll never figure you humans out. We're huge exemptions on your property, and I always earn my keep. I mow the yard daily, yet you still send us to Whataburger to be processed. How do you live with yourself?
We love Whataburger.
You're welcome.
As I was saying before I was so rudely interrupted, Joseph's family was from Bethlehem, so they had to take a long trip by foot.
Of course. My great-great-great-great-grandpappy was the faithful steed that had the privilege and honor of carrying poor Mary over those dusty and dirty roads. He had to go extra slow to make sure she wasn't too uncomfortable. He was like an airbag of safety, you know, with short legs.
Sounds like an awfully long trip. I bet you're glad when they invented cars.
So what happened when they finally arrived in Bethlehem?
Hey, Canadian bacon, get cracking.
Whatever you say, Rabbi. Well, they arrived later than everyone else, so Joseph had to go from inn to inn looking for a place to stay.
Hi, excuse me. You wouldn't happen to know if there's any Holiday Inns or Best Westerns in the area, would you? Oh, never mind. I have a coupon for Motel 6. They leave the light on for you.
This coupon is invalid. It's only good on weekdays. Plus, there's no room in any inn.
Listen, please, you have to help me out here. I can't go back to the wife with that answer. I'll be eating crow for a week. She told me we should have left a week ago, but I had a project to finish first.
Joseph, darling. Mr. Innkeeper, please help us. I'm a child and very tired. My dear husband is obviously in sticker shock. We didn't get a chance to search Trivago. What's the best you can do?
Well, it isn't much, but I have a barn in the back. There's no sleep number bed or air conditioning or even running water. But the wind and the rain come back from time to time.
Well, I'll be sure to write a lengthy story review. We'll take it. Thank you.
Luke 2, verse 6 and 7, it says, "And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered, and she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room in the inn."
According to my ancestors, they all settled in for the night with the shepherd standing guard with the pep talk.
Now, come on. How many times have I told you knuckleheads about peer pressure? Just because a few of your friends want to go jump off a cliff for a head rush doesn't mean you all have to follow in suit. All you sheep are practically hopeless without a shepherd. And why can't you all be leaders and not followers is beyond me. It's just so frustrating.
Sully?
Luke 2, verse 10 and 11, and the angel said unto them,
"Fear not, bring good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day, a city of David, a Savior is Christ the Lord."
To be chosen by God to spread the good news of Jesus' birth. He also gave us a special sign in the sky, a star that we could follow so that we would know where to find the baby Jesus.
My dear granny used to tell me the story of how they all bowed down and worshiped the new Messiah. It was a glorious day.
Yeah, and they made a huge ruckus in town going on and on about it. Why they couldn't wait until morning is beyond me.
Oh, be quiet, you old bag of bones. They couldn't contain their excitement. How could anyone with this news?
Oh,
orphan. Did you check the map?
Hey, Frankie and Goldie, I think we're lost. It keeps giving the wrong directions. It keeps saying Jesus is all at 290. That can't be right. I hate MapQuest.
Hey, look up at the sky. It's a bird. It's a plane. It's a star. OnStar!
Hello, this is OnStar. How may I be your service today?
Yes, we're looking for the Savior of the world.
Okay, one moment. Uploading now directions to the east, and thank you for using OnStar.
Finally. Hey guys, you can't greet the normal king without any gifts.
Good idea. I would bring him gold because he is the king of kings.
I'll bring him frankincense because he is God.
I will bring him myrrh because he will die for our sins.
Hey, pork chop, you're up.
You're utterly ridiculous. You know that, right? When they arrived in Jerusalem, the three wise men went to the palace expecting baby Jesus to be there. Instead, they found a jealous King Herod who didn't like the news that a king of the Jews had been born nearby.
When you find the child, come back and bring me the news so that I may worship him myself. Moo, ha ha ha.
This guy seems kind of shady to me.
Yeah, we'll be sure to ask OnStar for a different route home.
Well, this is awkward. Let's get out of here.
That sneaky old King Herod was plotting to kill the baby Jesus.
That dirty, rotten, good-for-nothing king. So then what happened?
The three wise men found him and bowed down before him and presented their gifts. Before they left, God warned them in a dream not to go back, but to find another route home. King Herod never found baby Jesus.
Ooh.
what did we miss? Did you get to the good part yet?
The good part?
Oh, yeah, my ancestors still talk about it to this day, but Oaky Olive and Pine Saw can tell it better than I can.
Well, it all started when my ancestor was born. She was just a baby, you know. She had this overwhelming dream day and night to become a spectacular treasure chest where she can hold diamonds, gold, silver, precious gems, and treasures of all kinds. One day, a carpenter came and cut her down. She was so excited because he chose her from all the other trees. She thought maybe she was going to end up in a huge museum where people can come from all over to see her treasure. But her hopes were chopped when she was made into an old food trough for a farm in Bethlehem. As her disappointment grew, what was basically being a dinner plate for the animals, she never lost hope that she'd become the best dinner plate there ever was.
Oki, we're so glad we got to host this year's family reunion in your branch resort. Also, thank you for the all-you-can-eat acorns. You're the best.
My pleasure. My ancestor was a strong tree. He had roots that dug deep in the valley. He was tough and could survive the most difficult conditions. He also had big dreams of becoming a huge, majestic ship that would hold the strongest army in the world. One day, some boatmakers were passing by and said, "Yes, let's use this one. He's strong and durable." They cut him down and made him into an ordinary fishing boat. He was tired of going from place to place, never anchoring anywhere. He was devastated, and as the days passed, he would just coast from shore to shore, swimming aimlessly into the deep, dreaming of a greater purpose.
Hello, everyone. I'm Pine Saul. No, I'm not the cleaner. I'm a pine tree, named after King Saul. I come from a long line of pine trees. Once they were the tallest trees in the world. One day, my great-granddaddy was as tall as any tree around. He had a big dream that he never wanted to be moved. He just wanted to stay put and point people to God. One dreary day, a storm took him by surprise. Lightning struck the branch and broke him in half. The tree, he was so depressed because he was useless, forgotten scrap, thrown by the wayside, never to be used again, or so he thought.
Many days later, an angel appeared to the shepherds in the night, sharing the good news of a Messiah being born, lying in a manger. A manger, another word for a food trough. The olive tree that once dreamed of holding great treasure, well, God let her hold the greatest treasure of all, the Savior of the world.
Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the tinsel and lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the carols and bells make the holiday swell, and it's all about you.
The holidays swell, and it's all
Jesus.
One night, an intense storm of great magnitude raged in the sea. This small, ordinary fishing boat had passengers aboard. Water was filling the boat. Waves were as high as the eye could see. With thunder and lightning striking constantly, they were frightened. One of the men called out to another man who was asleep on the boat, "Master, wake up! We are going to die out here!" Jesus awoke and calmed the sea and stopped the wind with his words, "Be still." Now, even though he had dreamed of being a majestic ship carrying an army, he had become the ship that carried the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
After many agonizing days of just sitting in a heap of useless frown scraps, soldiers came and picked up that old broken pine tree and carried it for many miles. The pine tree was made into a cross, and Jesus Christ was placed on that cross. The cross was planted on the hillside along with two others. The mob was horrendous and out of control. They kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" The soldiers placed Jesus Christ on the cross. He was the King of Jews and paid the penalty of sin, which was death. After many long hours of suffering, he cried, "It is finished." He gave up the ghost and died for us and the sins of the world. He was put in a tomb carved out of rock. 3 days later, he arose. He defeated death, hell, and the grave. To this day, that cross points people towards God, reminding us of his promise.
It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast.
Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Sometimes the dreams we have for ourselves are much smaller than the dreams God has for us. So dream big, God does.
God allowed the dreams of the trees to be used for his honor and glory. And he used his only son to die for you and I, so we can be reconciled with him in eternity one day.
Wow, what an amazing gift.
Yes, it's a free gift. We'll accept it today.
But how do you accept God's gift?
First of all, you must admit that you are a sinner, that you have broken God's law, and because of that, you can never do anything to earn heaven on your own.
Yep, it's not by going to church every Sunday, getting baptized, or trying to be a really good person. It is only by putting your trust in what Jesus has done for you on the cross.
Once you realize that Jesus paid the price for your sin and proved he has power over death and the grave because he died, was buried, and rose again the third day, then you simply put your trust in what he did on the cross, confess your sins, and ask him to be your Savior.
Can we do that right now?
You sure can. The Bible says today is the day of repentance. God is always willing to save whoever comes to him with a heart of repentance.
1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
You know, we promised that we wouldn't tell that you guys can talk on Christmas Eve, but this news is way too good to keep to ourselves.
I can't wait to share the good news with everyone I can.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his own.
Carry your candle to the darkness, seek out the helpless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world.
How he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame.
Carry your candle, run to the darkness. See?